Welcome to worship at the North Fairfield United Methodist Church, both those that you are here worshiping in person and those friends that are worshiping with us online. We'll just go over a couple of announcements this morning. If you remember, a few weeks back, we had South Central students here giving a pre-performance concert. We'll get the same opportunity this week, Tuesday, with some junior high students. We'll be coming Tuesday for a concert at 6 o'clock, a pre-concert performance to get them ready for contests. So Tuesday at 6 o'clock, if you would like to attend that. And Wednesday at 6:30, we have a leadership board meeting. Are there any other announcements? Matt?
Just along the lines of the junior high pre-concert performance, if anybody would be interested in donating some cookies to share with everyone afterwards, that would be great. You don't have to sign up or anything. Just if you are available to make cookies, please just drop them off in the basement before the concert. Thank you.
All right. Any other announcements? All right. Seeing none, if you would stand, if able, and prepare ourselves for worship by joining in, "Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place." Please join with me responsibly in the call to worship. God loves us with a steadfast love.
Let the name of the Lord say so.
God loves us so much, he gave us his Son.
Let us believe and have eternal life.
God loves us with a great love, rich in mercy.
Let us have faith to receive his grace.
Give thanks to the Lord, for God is good. Let us pray. Lord, as we gather here on this day of sharing, remind us that you have shared with us your most precious gift, our Lord Jesus Christ. Help us to model our lives after his messages of compassion and service to you and to all your world. In Christ's name, we offer this prayer. Amen. Now please join in our opening hymn, "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing." Page 4. Be seated. This morning's scripture reading comes from Numbers chapter 21, verses 4 through 9. They traveled from Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea to go around Edom, but the people grew impatient on the way. They spoke against God and against Moses and said, "Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the desert? There is no bread, there is no water, and we detest this miserable food." Then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them. They bit the people, and many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We sinned when we spoke against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us." So Moses prayed for the people. The Lord said to Moses, "Make a snake and put it up on a pole. Anyone who is bitten can look at it and live." So Moses made a bronze snake and put it up on a pole. Then when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, he lived. May God add his blessing to the reading of his holy word.
Good morning. Good to see you, all of you. Yeah, it's great to be in the house of the Lord. Recently, I recognized that now we are in the two seasons, spring and winter. So last Sunday was beautiful, and this Sunday we have snow. So I think we are in the transitional season. It is great to be here today. This time is the sharing time. Do you have any joys and concerns and prayers?
We have two prayer concerns. My Uncle Art, who lives out in Seattle, he's my dad's twin brother. He's been to the ER twice just recently. The last time he fell and he hit his head and he broke his wrist. My uncle will be 90 in December, so this is, they're having some difficulty right now with that, so. But prayers for my Uncle Art. And then also for Kevin, he goes in to have cataract surgery on Wednesday.
Okay, yes. Actually, last week I asked to pray for my English teacher, Judy. She came back home, so she's getting much better. So thank for your prayers. Also this morning I heard that Dottie has stroke. No, just fell down. So we need to pray for Dottie. Also Dwight is exposed to COVID, so she could not come this morning. Yes. Okay, let us pray. Great Triune God, we have gathered here in your name, in your incredible love. You gave your one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life. Thank you, Lord, for your great love in Jesus Christ. Lord, let us receive the gift of love and the gift of salvation in Christ, in solid belief and grateful heart. Lord, fill us with the light of life in Jesus Christ. Let us love the light, pursuing truth, justice, peace, and great. Today, Lord, as we are in your house, so we ask your continuing blessing upon each of us. Renew us, strengthen us, bless us, so that we may be a blessing for one another. Today we give thanks for hearing some members are recovered from sickness. So we ask your continuing blessing upon each of them. This morning, dear Lord, we pray for Art, the Elaine's uncle, who fell down and is in recovery process. So fill them with your comforting grace and give him enough strength. And we ask your healing grace upon him. Also, we pray for Dottie, who fell down last week. So give her strength and peace and healing grace. Today we lift up our prayers for Kevin, who will have the Cadillac surgery Wednesday. So be in all medical process and all recovery process. Today, dear Lord, now we pray for church members who are out of town and who will have a travel. So bless each of them and keep them in safety and also with enjoyment. Today, dear Lord, now we pray for those who are in recovery and treatment. So you know their struggles. So we ask your blessings upon each of them to give them strength and peace and healing grace. Today, dear Lord, now as we look for our world, so we see many people are suffering by the wars. Dear Lord, deliver us from this tragedy of the wars so that innocent people can be survived. They can live in their family with enjoyment. Today, dear Lord, now we are here to worship you and open our minds and our hearts. So we come nearer to you and we are filled with your grace. This time, dear Lord, now we lift up our unspoken prayers for ourselves, family, and our neighbors and the world. This time, let us take a moment, silent moment, for our prayers. Let us pray with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This time is the children's time. Children, could you come to the front? Good morning. How are you today? I'm great to see you. Do you like snow? Do you like snow? It's okay. Yeah, it's okay. Yeah, it's okay. Yeah, it's fine. Yeah. Yeah. Today, I brought this the cross. So in this cross, there is my favorite Bible passage. Maybe you know this one. So could you, so Landon, could you read this one? Mm-hmm. Yeah. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, right? So God so loved the world and that he gave his only one son. It comes from John 3:16. Today I brought three things. This one is, what is this one? Measuring ball. Oh yeah, measuring ball, right? To make a cookie, what kind of things you put? To make a cookie, what we need? Water, flour, and maybe milk, right? So at the time we need to measure how much we'll put water, flour, and milk, right? So we need to put here. We need this kind of measuring ball. But according to Psalm chapter 23:5, David said, my cup overflows with your grace. So actually we cannot measure how God's love is abundant, right? We cannot measure God's love. What is this one? Tape measure, right? Yeah. This one is the tape measure, right? Yeah. So we can measure maybe how tall you are. You know how tall you are? Not 6 feet. Not yet, right? Maybe 4 feet? I'm not sure, right? So we can measure how tall we are. Maybe we can measure how tall this sanctuary is. We can measure. But psalmist said, I cannot measure how God's love is great. God's love is higher than heaven, deeper than sea. So actually we cannot measure how God's love is. Yeah? What is this one? Yeah, watch. So sometimes we watch how long our service will be, how long pastors will give a sermon, right? So we check up with our watch, right? So we don't know how long God's love is. A psalmist said, God's love is forever, everlasting to everlasting. Actually, we cannot measure how God's love is. So this one today, let us know that God so loves you, right? So let us remember God loves us. Okay, so let us pray. Thank you, Lord. You loved the world. You love us. So that you gave your one and only son. Lord, bless. Give us the gift of faith so that we can receive your gift. Dear Lord, bless our children so they can live in your love and they can love the light in Christ. So we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you. Okay. Do you like this one? Yeah, choco pie. Choco pie, yes. Okay, so I can give you for your brother, his name? Leilin.
Leilin, yes. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. Today's scripture reading, John chapter 3, 14 to 21. So if you are able to, could you stand up? Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send the Son, his Son, into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but men loved darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what he has done has been done through God. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. This time we'll sing hymn number 402, Lord, I Want to Be a Christian. I think that having dialogues with one another is a unique blessing which is granted upon us human beings. Along with walking with two legs and using two hands, through dialogues we share our own thoughts, feelings, and hopes with one another. We know that no one is on island, so we live together. Especially through dialogues, we express ourselves and understand one another. Reading the Gospels, I recognize that Jesus was a genius in conversation with insight, compassion, wisdom, and authority. It is the reason why those who dialogued with Jesus were amazed, challenged, affirmed, or awakened. It is great for us to read the dialogues which were exchanged between Jesus and his disciples or others and reflect them along with learning in each dialogue's lines. Actually, we are learning in the lines. Today's passage, John chapter 3, 1 through 21, begins with the dialogue between Jesus and Nicodemus. Maybe private dialogue between Jesus and Nicodemus. Gathered close around a lamp or a fire. As humans have done for millennia, when night falls, then it turns into a discourse, monologue, speech or sermon by Jesus. So this picture is the scene, the conversation, dialogue between Jesus and Nicodemus. One day, a man of Pharisees named Nicodemus, a member of the Jewish ruling council, came to Jesus at night. He opens a dialogue with Jesus. This scene represents both positive and negative images of Nicodemus. On the positive side, Nicodemus seeks out Jesus. As you may recognize, seeking Jesus is a great step to know Jesus, learn from Jesus, and receive the gift that Jesus gives. So in Jeremiah chapter 29, 13 says, "You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart." So when we seek the Lord with our heart, God promised, He will sought, He will found. However, on the negative side, Nicodemus hides his seeking under the cloak of night. Like King Zedekiah visited Jeremiah at night. It is notable that night, not in Greek, is used metaphorically in the Gospel of John to represent separation from the presence of God. So several times the night is using metaphorically, separation from God's presence. In John chapter 11, 9 to 10, Jesus said, "A man who walks by day will not stumble, for he sees this world's light. It is when he walks by night that he stumbles, for he has no light." It reminds me of one of my grandparents who lived in a small country without an electricity. So when I was childhood in 1970s around, at that time in rural area, we didn't have electricity. So night time, so dark. So my grandmother used to say to me, "Do not wander outside at night." Several times I remember. John chapter 13, 30 says, "As soon as Judas has taken the bread, he went out, and it was night." The evangelist of the first gospel, John, declares that Jesus came into the world as the light of life, and as the true light that gives light to everyone, every man. In chapter 8, 12, Jesus declares by himself, "I am light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Sure, night represents separation from the presence of God, who are Christ, the light of the world. So Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Yet isn't it admirable that Nicodemus sought Jesus even at night and initiated a dialogue with Jesus? In today's text, we can feel that Nicodemus and Jesus are deeply engaged in the dialogue. The conversation began with Nicodemus' nice words, "Rabbi, we know you are a teacher who has come from God. No one could perform the miraculous signs you are doing if God were not with him." Even though Nicodemus seemed to know the identity of Jesus, actually, he does not know who Jesus is. His attitude will be challenged as the dialogue with Jesus unfolds. Jesus does not respond directly to Nicodemus' acknowledgement of him. Instead, Jesus challenged him with the introductory formula, "Very truly, I tell you." Three times Jesus said, "Very truly, I tell you." Jesus brought a truth before Nicodemus, saying, "I tell you the truth. No one can seek the kingdom of God unless he is born again." The Greek word anoten means both from above and again or new. This double meaning is possible only in Greek. There is no Hebrew or Aramaic word with a similar double meaning. Jesus' expression "to be born" and "anoten," that is to be born from above or again, challenges Nicodemus to move beyond surface meaning to a deeper meaning. Here it is noteworthy that "to be born" or "anoten" speaks both of a time of birth again and the place from which this new birth is generated from above. In our dialogues, we used to say to others this: "You look only one side of the shield. Look at the world," right? Sometimes we used to say this one: "You look only one side. Look at whole picture." I know that on many occasions, we used to see only one side or superficial aspect. In the conversation, Jesus strongly wished to let Nicodemus know the other side of born again, or its deeper meaning, because no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. Yet Nicodemus is not oblivious to the two levels of meaning in anoten, and protested what Jesus calls for is physiologically impossible. Thus Nicodemus asked, "How can a man be born when he is old?" Then he affirms by himself, "Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born." In this dialogue, we can see Nicodemus, who remains in ignorance and confusion, yet still seeking. Here we also see Jesus, who listens to Nicodemus and strives to open Nicodemus' mind and heart so that he may understand the meaning of born again and recognize its necessity. This text makes us readers engage in this dialogue so we may recognize its meaning and necessity. The necessity of born again, the preciousness of born again. Surely the phrase born again was formed out of this text. This expression born again has become a slogan for an entire segment of contemporary Christian experience. Indeed, the validity of a person's faith is frequently judged by whether one has been born again or not. Indeed, born again or from the above is needy and precious. Yet, a biblical scholar commented this text as followed. To interpret anathon as describing spiritual rebirth through personal conversion can disregard the decisive Christological dimension of anathon, both from above through the lifting up of Jesus on the cross. Contemporary usage of born again privileges anthropology over Christology. That is, it emphasizes personal change more than the external source of the change, the cross. I think this commentary is written a little difficult, but I understand what he is saying in this saying. Sometimes just we are focusing on our personal experience. When he meet Christ, when he got grace from Jesus Christ. Sometimes born again experience is more than cross itself. So we acknowledge that we are born again Christians. But sometimes the personal experience is over who Christ is. Of course, born again Christians will say that I or we are totally transformed by the grace of Jesus Christ, who died for us and has risen for our sake. Yet, we need to look at Jesus and lift high the cross until all the world adores his sacred name. I think that it is the reason the dialogue between Jesus and Nicodemus was changed into the discourse, the teaching or sermon in monologue by Jesus. So Jesus recognized that, should explain what means to be born again. In the discourse, Jesus brings the story in Numbers 21 to let Nicodemus and his community look at the Son of Man so that they may live. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. Here, the verb lift takes our attention. We need to know that the verb hypsu in Greek means both lift up and exalt. First, the verb lift hypsu indicates the crucifixion that Jesus took. Yet, this verb also means being exalted by his resurrection and ascension. Thus, it tells that Jesus is crucified and exalted for our sake. We are all invited to look at Jesus, who was lifted crucified and exalted so that we may live. Indeed, Jesus, through being lifted up, death and resurrection, made eternal life possible for those who believe. John 3:16 declares the gospel of gospels. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Reading the Gospel of John, we find that eternal life, eternity, is consistently referred. This is the most valuable gift that God gives to those who believe in Christ. 3:36, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. In 5:20, Jesus declared, whoever hears my word and believes in him who sent me has eternal life. Yet we need to be aware that eternal does not mean mere endless duration of human existence, but it's a way of describing life as lived in an unending presence of God with righteousness, peace, and joy, as Paul declared. To have eternal life is to be given life as a child of God. Eternal life is not something held in pause until the believer's future, but begins in the believer's present. The Gospel of John tells that eternity begins now, when he believes in Christ, when he follows him. Reflecting 3:16 called the Gospel of Gospels, I recognized two things. First, I see God's incredible love. That is, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. Secondly, I see the necessity and preciousness to accept the gift of Jesus. Whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. The following verse, verse 17, lets us know what God intends for us. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Here, don't we clearly hear that God sent Jesus not to condemn the world, but to save the world through him? Surely Jesus declared that the Son came not to condemn, but to save. Yet I feel that in Christianity, the gospel may have misused or weaponized toward those who do not believe in Jesus, forgetting God's intention not to condemn the world, but to save the world through Jesus Christ. To say again, in John chapter 3:16 shows how much God's great love in Christ. But suddenly, in Christianity, this kind of gospel may have become kind of a judgment. If God didn't send Jesus to condemn the world, but to save the world through Jesus, then we aren't called to condemn the world either. So this verse makes us look over whether we have easily condemned the world, or whether the gospel of love becomes a threat. without compassionate love for those who may lose. Let us keep that God sent Jesus to save the world, not condemn. Then let love be central. This is what loving the light means. Maybe like you, I love the light. I like moonlight. I like the sunlight. I like pictures with light. I love the light that God illumines in Jesus Christ. We can say what loving the light indicates in several ways. We choose that which heals. We choose that which transforms. We choose that which honors, respects, and sees all the people. We do not overlook anyone because Jesus did not look over anyone. Jesus says that the Son came not to condemn, but to save. And though many of us know that God's intention is at saving the world, not condemning, we frequently used to fall in pointing fingers. Yet, we aren't given that authority or responsibility. Again and again, Jesus says that judgment is his job and not ours. So Matthew chapter 7, do not judge. Romans chapter 12, rely on God, who judges everything. Instead, we are called to love the light. What does it mean to love the light? How will people learn to change their hearts and minds? How will people know that they need a savior at all? It's simple. As people receive mercy, grace, acceptance from us, they will want to know more about Christ, about God. So in Matthew chapter 5, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven." Today's passage ends with an exhortation to love the light. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be plainly seen that what he has done has been done through God. Dear friends, today's text includes many significant lessons like a treasure box, such as double or deep meaning of born again or from the above, and the wind, natural or spiritual, lift, crucifixion or exaltation, God's saving work through Jesus' descension and ascension, God's intention to save the world, not to condemn it, the necessity and preciousness to believe in Jesus, and so on. Actually, in today's passage in John chapter 3, like a treasure box, lots of incredible things are there. Even though these all are important and needy, let us keep two things in our hearts. First, God's intention to save the world through his Son's sacrificial love, not to condemn it. So, love needs to be central in our journey. Second, Jesus' call to love the light. Receiving Jesus, who is the light of life and pursuing the light of truth in a love. I pray that God may guide us all into this journey to love the light. All God's people say, Amen. Thank you for your offering to God. This time, singing doxology, we offer our offerings to God. Pray together, prayer of thanksgiving. God of unavailing love, you have held nothing back in your love for us, not even your Son. How we marvel at that kind of love, and how we long to reflect a portion of that devotion back to you. As we dedicate our offerings to you, lead us away from our tendency to hold back and worry that there will be not be enough. Help us to live as the people of love and abundance you have called us to be. In Christ we pray, Amen. So closing hymn, I want to walk as a child of the light, hymn number 206. May God let us look up to Jesus, who was lifted on the cross for us and was exalted in ascension so that we may have eternal life. May God fill us with divine grace and spirit so that we may be born again from above. May God bless us all so that we may dwell in your love and walk in light and life, loving the light in Christ. All God's people say, Amen.